Hello and welcome, everyone. I'm Tricia Edwards, Deputy Director of Smithsonian Affiliations, and I'm so glad to have you all with us today. We're pleased to welcome you to our program, The Legacy of the Green Book, about Victor Hugo Green, a Harlem postman and his Jim Crow era travel guide for Black Americans. The Green Book, as it was known, was a sustained success for nearly 30 years, providing Black travelers with information on hotels, restaurants, service stations, and other facilities where they could expect welcome without humiliation. Today, we'll explore the legacy of the Green Book, its impact on communities, businesses, and families, and its relevance today. I'm looking forward to what I know is going to be an interesting and thought-provoking discussion. Before we get started, we have just a few housekeeping items. The program is being recorded. The link will be posted on the Smithsonian Affiliations YouTube page in the coming days. We'll also make sure that everyone who registered today receives a link to the program. If you have comments, please use the chat box, and it's great to already see so much activity in there and to see people from all over joining us. If you have questions for our presenters, please enter those in the Q&A box. You should see a link to the Q&A in the toolbar on your Zoom screen. Our staff will be monitoring both the chat and the Q&A. And please note that while on-topic discussion is encouraged, we ask that you express yourself in a civil manner and treat others with respect. The Smithsonian monitors comments and may remove participants from the program in accordance with its terms of use. A link to the Smithsonian's terms is in the chat for your reference. Closed captioning is available. Just click the closed caption button on your screen and captions will appear. If you have a technical issue or a question unrelated to today's discussion, please use the raise your hand feature or type it in the chat box and a Smithsonian staff member will assist you. At Smithsonian Affiliations, we partner with museums and cultural organizations across the country to support them and their communities, people like all of you joining us today, while also furthering the Smithsonian's mission, the increase and diffusion of knowledge. Like the Smithsonian, our affiliate partners are committed to education and public service and work in collaboration with the Smithsonian to catalyze critical conversations in their communities and help us all better understand the world around us. This work seems more important now than ever before as we, like all of you, grapple with so many big issues, including the effects of a global pandemic, political divisiveness, and of course, racial injustice. Today's program is a great example of the ways in which the Smithsonian and our affiliates work together to bring thought-provoking and relevant content to audiences like you. With the help of 25 affiliate organizations, we are able to bring this program to just about 1,000 people today, far more than we could serve with an in-person program. And we're able to start a conversation not with one community, but across many, from Rhode Island to Arizona, Texas to Washington, Maryland to Montana. And it's great to see so many of those states represented in the chat. Smithsonian Affiliations is pleased to host today's program in collaboration with the Smithsonian Institution Traveling Exhibition Service, also known as SITES. The program is inspired by SITES' new exhibition, The Negro Motorist Green Book, about the reality of travel for African Americans during the Jim Crow era, and the important role the Green Book played as an indispensable resource for the nation's rising African American middle class. The exhibition opened earlier this month at the National Civil Rights Museum, an affiliate museum in Memphis, Tennessee, and a partner in today's program. Before I introduce our featured speakers, I want to acknowledge a special guest. Lee Van Allen, the owner of Shearer Cottage in Oak Bluff, Massachusetts, is with us today. Located on Martha's Vineyard, Shearer Cottage has catered to Black vacationers since the early 1900s. The cottage has been family-owned and operated since 1903 and was featured in the Green Book. Shearer Cottage is also featured in the Negro Motorist Green Book exhibition, as well as in the Power of Place exhibition at the Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture. Lee, thank you so much for being with us today. Now I am delighted to welcome and introduce our featured speakers. Marquette Folly is a social and cultural historian, an exhibition developer, and project manager. She came to the Smithsonian in 1983 as a fellow to work on the National Museum of American History exhibition, Field to Factory, Afro-American Migration, 1915 to 1940. Later, she joined the museum's curatorial staff in the musical history division and worked to increase and broaden its jazz holdings. Currently, Marquette is content director at the Smithsonian Institution Traveling Exhibition Service. At Sites, she was co-curator of the exhibition and book titled Seeing Jazz, an exhibition developer and project director for the traveling exhibitions Men of Change, Power, Triumph, Truth, 100 Faces of War, Robert Blackburn and Modern American Printmaking, and the Negro Motorist Green Book. Marquette will be leading a discussion with Candacy Taylor, an award-winning author, photographer, and cultural documentarian. Candacy is the author of Overground Railroad, The Green Book, and The Roots of Black Travel in America, and is the curator and content specialist of the Negro Motorist Green Book exhibition. Since 2013, Candacy has crisscrossed America 5 times scouting and photographing Green Book sites. Her work has been featured in over 50 media outlets, including The Atlantic, CBS Sunday Morning, The Guardian, The Los Angeles Times, The New York Times, Newsweek, PBS NewsHour, and The Wall Street Journal. Candacy was a fellow at the Hutchins Center at Harvard University under the direction of Henry Louis Gates Jr., and her projects have been commissioned and funded by numerous organizations, including the Library of Congress, National Geographic, the American Council of Learned Societies, the National Endowment for Humanities, the National Park Service, the National Trust for Historic Preservation, and the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture. Marquette, I'll turn it over to you.
Technology. Thank you, Tricia, and thank you all for joining us. When the first Green Book was published, the American road was a metaphor for freedom. Freedom to change your present situation, freedom to determine your destiny, freedom to travel. Yet, in 20th century America, this same road was a dangerous place for Black citizens. The land was divided by segregation, through policy or through custom. If you were Black, the prejudice was severe, a systemic effort to deny access to your basic human rights. Imagine the indignity of government-backed and socially normalized oppression. Imagine the pain, the violence, the disrespect. And yet, and still, African Americans created destinations and strategies that affirmed their humanity, their worth, their light, their lives, and took to the roads. It was done with ingenuity, with community, and with the help of a man named Victor Green and his travel guide, the Negro Motorist Green Book. Thank you for joining us today. We celebrate the Green Book, and we're honored to be able to confer with Candacy Taylor. Candacy.
Yes.
When did you discover the Green Book? And why did you think it was important to research?
Well, I discovered the Green Book by accident. Is my video supposed to be on? I don't see. I'm just wondering if.
You're okay. You look great.
I don't see it. Okay. I discovered the Green Book by accident. I was actually commissioned to write a travel guide on Route 66. And I couldn't believe that once I learned that Route 66, half the counties on Route 66 were sundown towns, I just wondered, well, how did Black people travel this road? And when I asked that question, it just led me to the Green Book. And I saw my first copy at the Autry Museum in Los Angeles. I couldn't believe such a thing had existed. It was about 2013 when I discovered this, and I ran out and I called my parents and I said, you know, do you know about this? Have you heard about this? And my mother hadn't, but my stepfather Ron had, and it led to a very long and special friendship with him in terms of him telling me more about his discovery, leaving the South, and his trauma, really, from segregation and Jim Crow, growing up as a dark-skinned man in the Jim Crow South. And he told me many stories, some of which are in my book, but that led me to this whole nother world of discovery, learning and loving the Green Book.
So tell us about the Green Book. What was it? How and when did it begin?
The Green Book was a travel guide. It was published for Black people during the Jim Crow era. It started in 1936, and it traveled all the way, it was published all the way until 1967. So it spanned three decades. It was mostly annual. Really, some of the years, it did take a hiatus between 1942 and 1945. But 1936 was the first year. But the only edition that we have is 1937. That's the only thing we have evidence of in terms of the first Green Book, which is what's pictured here. And that's not even the cover, but that's all we have to go on right now. And obviously we're out there looking for that first edition if anybody has it or has seen it. But yes, it was really special because it started in Harlem. It was a solution to a pretty horrific problem. There were mostly only Harlem and Westchester County locations, some nightclubs, but mostly actually auto repair shops. There was a lot of car businesses, auto businesses, and gasoline places and mechanics. And it was very much about the car. And it wasn't, by 1940, nearly half of the country, or every state east of the Mississippi River, was in the Green Book. So it grew very, very, very fast. And we can talk about more, we'll talk about more later.
Because that was a real need for something. Now, granted, we know that Black Americans figured out how to travel the roads where danger could lurk at the most obscene moments. They learned how to pack their trunks with provisions so they didn't have to stop at places to be humiliated or worse. They learned which places were safe. There was a route there. They did, in traveling, people also left late at night. As you mentioned earlier, so to not be seen. So its popularity, the Green Book's popularity, is part of a whole story, isn't it? There were other travel guides.
Right.
There's something special about the Green Book.
Exactly, yes. There were other travel guides. There were probably roughly about a dozen of them. So it was very, the Green Book wasn't the first. The first Black Traveler's Guide was Hackley and Harrison's, 1930. It only lasted 1 year. But the Green Book was so incredible, and it was the longest standing of all of them. And it outshined all of them for so many reasons, because it really did capture this breadth of America. It reached so far and wide. It was actually became an international guide. It was listed in 30 countries in Africa. So it really did, beyond anything any other Black Traveler's Guide tried to accomplish. The Green Book was really the premier guide. But it did take a while. And I'm sure when Victor Green started it, I think he was really just trying to make sure he could just go to the certain places in Harlem, because Harlem was segregated in 1935 when he started it. So I think he was solving his own problem and then ended up creating something pretty spectacular.
I like that phrase, solving his own problem, because it was a problem of African Americans. And so many African Americans had left the South to come north or west for more freedom, more opportunity. And one of those people is his elegant wife, Alma, who lived in Richmond, Virginia. So I can envision Green need also to find a way to chart the territory as he took his beloved wife home. It must have become evident a need for a guide, a kind of North Star or quilt along the way for Black travelers in the 1930s.
Right, yeah. Victor Green was driving his wife, Alma, to and from Richmond, Virginia, from Harlem pretty regularly. And he also had a friend who was Jewish at the time, was using a Jewish, it wasn't really a traveler's guide, it was more of a kosher guide on what to, where to eat when he left New York and went to the Borscht Belt, left the city, and he would go on his vacation. So Victor Green thought, well, this would be pretty useful. Something like this would help me when I'm driving Alma, you know, to Virginia. So, and of course, Alma's brother who lived with them, Bob, was a really established musician. And so he taught lessons, music lessons, out of their home in Sugar Hill. So there were a lot of musicians hanging around. And we also assume that, you know, musicians, especially at that time that were traveling, may have used a Chitlin circuit, but they thought, man, this would be really helpful if we had a guide that really showed us state by state, city by city, where we could go.
So when I think about Victor Green, a postman until he retired, I think about creativity, innovation, entrepreneurship. What is Victor Green's story from your perspective? How did do it? How did he manage to have? Because there's something amazing, as you just said, about the Green Book. It lasted for almost 30 years. That's phenomenal.
Mm-hmm. Right, yeah, and you know, he had so many different strategies. It was kind of a multi-pronged marketing manifesto. I mean, it was really incredible because he not only had he was a postal worker from Harlem. He had a seventh grade education. So he didn't have like an MBA, right? He didn't need that to pull this off. But he worked with so many different unions. There was a white postal workers union, which ironically he belonged to. But there was a black postal workers union as well. And so he partnered with them. And made sure that when they were out on their beat, that they knew about the Green Book and they would help solicit advertising for his guide. So, and it was a win-win because these black postal workers were relegated to the black communities. And so there were a lot of black businesses in those communities, and that was a ready-made audience of people who needed more business. It didn't cost anything to advertise in the Green Book unless you wanted a bigger ad or you wanted a full page or something. So it was a win-win. But then he also had Esso gas stations. He also had other partnerships he had made with James Jackson. There were so many things that really helped basically collect all of this extra activity and interest in the Green Book. So it was a really critical, you know, again, I don't think he would have started out with this business plan. But yet in the same way that Madam C.J. Walker or some of the other great entrepreneurs of our time, especially within the black community, he really did marshal this resource of power of and empowerment for us and by us. So it was pretty spectacular.
How did he get businesses to advertise within his Green Book? You know, to have those ads, how did he solicit those? Was it wasn't just with the postman, was it also a kind of engagement of promising businesses that were black owned or that welcomed black travelers? How did he move that forward?
He had a lot of ads in the Green Book seeking advertising, right? And so he'd have these little catchy phrases like, you know, you too can have more money, you know, more. I mean, travel as an industry at that time was still, it was a very different world. You know, there wasn't a ready-made, there wasn't Yelp or any internet, you know, there was no way for people to really get the word out. So the fact that, especially within the black community, so the fact that Victor Green had these Green Books happening at that time every year, it started to become more of a brand. It was at most Esso gas stations. It was there. So there was, when a business would look in the Green Book and say, oh, you can advertise here, you know, basically for nothing. It was a win-win because the businesses thought, what can I lose? And there were a lot of different kinds of businesses. It became more than just a travel guide. There were about 70,000 black-owned businesses in America at that time when the Green Book started. And so the Green Book had not just food and lodging, it had doctors and sanitariums and all different kinds of liquor stores and beauty shops and barber shops and anything you think, drug stores, anything you think you might ever need on the road. Banks were in the Green Book. It was there. So these earlier editions were really critical. And I think they spoke to how different it was in terms of segregation, because it grew, it really changed over time. We'll talk about that a little later. But yeah, it was a very important, I think, mirror of what was really happening in our culture at that time, what kinds of businesses there were, and the fact that primarily most of them were Black owned was, you know, pretty significant.
Yes, when I think about the Green Book, I think about evidence that there was this vital, thriving, parallel world of sorts of Black businesses, large and small, elegant people, consuming and building and creating for an African-American world that at this time, in this time period, early 20th century, mid 20th century in the United States, that was almost unseen, yeah, unknown, but true. And for popular culture, unknown, but for African-Americans, true. The Green Book is for me this evidence of a thriving Black world that gets undertold, I think. Also, when I think about Victor Green, I think about a man that had vision that was beyond just commercial success, financial success. He, for a very long time, didn't his Green Book sport a quote from Mark Twain? And then he had writings within the book that talked about, in aspirational ways, how to move forward. He profiled individuals that were doing very good things for the race. I think of Green as more than, not that being a business, creative business person isn't art, but there's, and visionary, but there seemed to be something of propelling his people forward that was part of Victor Green's story. Would you agree?
Absolutely. And I think that's also what made him a real fully fleshed out person of this time, because I think it's really easy when we look back at, especially these people who were so innovative and had all of these interesting ideas, it's really easy to just pigeonhole them into one thing. And I think he was really this man of the moment. And, you know, in the early editions, he went to every single place and he verified every single listing until it got too large. And then he had representatives come in. But yeah, I mean, Mark Twain, I mean, bringing Twain in onto the cover of most of his guy, Travel is Fatal to Prejudice, you know, all of those really wonderful things was, I think, just made him this more well-rounded person. And plus, you know, another thing is he found a white publisher to actually publish a guide, Howard Glenner. I mean, he went to Midtown, left Harlem, went to Midtown, which was very unusual for a Black man to show up at a white printer and say, hey, I have this guide. Most people denied him. They wouldn't print his book, but he kept going. He was an entrepreneur at heart. And I think he was a problem solver at heart. And I don't think he was deterred very easily. Based on a lot of the more I learned about him, I mean, I tried to find anything I could about him as I was writing my book, but he was a very distinguished man. He was very tall. He was always really well dressed. He and Alma were just very, you know, they lived in Sugar Hill. Duke Ellington was catty corner across the street. I mean, there was just this vibrancy, and they were always dressed to the nines, and they had this, they didn't have a lot of money, but they had a lot of class and a lot of, their stature in the community was really established. So I think all of those things, he was like this Renaissance man. You know, like I said, even though he had a seventh grade education, he was very worldly and very intelligent and handsome, and you know, he was pretty special.
I love you mentioning Harlem, New York. What are some of the, which is, I think, imbue some of the energy of the Green Book. It just seems to inform, and the way you described both Victor Green and his wife, Alma, and where they lived. But there were this array of businesses. Could you talk a little bit more about the businesses that found their way inside the Green Book and were amazing businesses that said to any human being, but specifically to Black Americans, you're welcome here, you're human here. Could you talk about some of the other businesses?
Right, yeah, there were so many. When I first started this project, Wikipedia said there were 1,500 Green Book sites. And because we only had two editions to really go on, and thankfully the Schomburg Center digitized their complete collection. They have about 24 Green Books, Green Book editions, and it is fabulous. You can just Google NYPL Green Book and you can see them and look through all of them. So once I did my fellowship with the Schomburg, I cataloged about 10,000 Green Book sites compared to the 1,500 Wikipedia thought we had. So there were incredible number of these businesses, everything from Dookie Chase restaurant, you know, in New Orleans, led by the fabulous legendary Leah Chase. She was the chef there. It's still vibrant and wonderful place to go eat. Thankfully, they're still open. I found that only about 3% of these businesses are still operating. So it's really special when we find some that are still operating, or for the exhibition, we found all these wonderful artifacts and objects from these businesses. It's very rare. I mean, it's rare for any business to last for 5 years, let alone 80, 90 years. So we have things like, you know, like I said, the Dookie Chase or the Dunbar in Los Angeles, Duke Ellington and Sarah Vaughan and Billie Holiday would hang out there. The Russonian in Denver was another legendary nightclub. These were the places where Black musicians would play their B-sides. They knew that they weren't playing that downtown for the white folks. So what you could get at these places, the type of music and the beautiful clothes and the way people dress. I mean, the Hampton House had a dress code. You had to show up dressed. Martin Luther King tried out his I Have a Dream speech there. Malcolm X was proselytized Muhammad Ali. He walked in as Cassius Clay and left as Muhammad Ali. I mean, there's incredible moments of history that happened in these places. There's the Ben Moore Hotel where King strategized the Montgomery bus boycott in 1954. And I got to interview his barber, who also worked in the Ben Moore Hotel. And they were all perched at the window on that day, seeing if the guy who always got on the bus, if he was gonna get on the bus that morning. And when he didn't, they thought this is gonna work. You know, so it's not just that these were businesses, they were places where really important historical things happened. And the fact that we've lost so many of these places is also a very, you know, it's very sad. So I think it's really important to celebrate it. And this exhibition is so great in doing that, because now that we have these artifacts actually from these businesses, we can say, oh my gosh, I mean, the cash register that we have from Threet's filling station is just a stunning thing in and of itself. The fact that it came from a site that served Black folks, it actually was not, it's one of the few objects that was not from the Green Book, but it was a legendary and iconic and very well traveled, and it was a very important filling station on Route 66, and there were so few of them, it was very important that they were there. So that is why we included Threet's filling station. But
you did find extraordinary pieces. Some of them, the Threet's cash register, I agree, is really very handsome, and the Sweats sign, very yeah. handsome. And as you mentioned, these are so rare, and sometimes they would look ordinary, like for instance plates or etc., or shards from a Murray's Dude Ranch. Oh. But these are like Hope diamonds as far as I'm concerned, because of the rarity, because yeah. of sustained history that's embodied inside of them. I also love the fact that we were able to have on loan implements of beauty shops from Mosaic Templars, who are on our tour, as a matter of fact. But those kind of pieces become metaphor for how many women-owned businesses Victor Green had populating his Green Book. Right. I think that's an extraordinary part of the story too,
Yeah.
Again, evidence of women owning businesses and so many.
Yeah, there were about 1,400 tourist homes in the Green Book, and that was really the first Airbnbs, right? I mean, that was really what we did. And they were mostly run by widowed women or by married women, but they were very key. And then there, of course, there was the beauty shops. In some cities, there were more beauty shops than hotels and food listed in the Green Book. That's how much of a priority they came into the guide. So yes, women played a big role. By 1959, it was published and edited by Alma Duke Green, by Victor Green's wife. Victor Green dies in 1960. So he never lives to see really the passage of the Civil Rights Act. The Green Book still lives on and Alma takes it over. But when you look at that 1959 edition, you see that on the masthead, they're all women, except for one that has initials and we don't know the gender of that person. But it was primarily a women-run enterprise at that point.
You know, what's extraordinary is that embodying the Green Book story and Victor Green and his vision, you have all these relevant contemporaneous stories right now. Again, evidence of people being fully in agency of what they're doing and how they're doing, in spite of being in an atmosphere that wants to relegate you because of the virtue of the color of your skin to subordinate. And this story also allows us, and Victor Green's work allows us to understand how broadly Jim Crow, segregation, sundown towns existed across the United States. Green wasn't just showing you pathways to go to the South, he was also showing you pathways north and west. There are Green Book, necessary Green Book sites around the nation.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I think that was really critical in terms of its reach. I mean, I think in some ways, you know, it was not, and it wasn't, we can't take it for granted that they were included. I mean, there was the state of North Dakota was the last one to really sign on. And it was every year, it was like, wow, North Dakota's still not in. It's still, I mean, until late 40s. And then you see a series of letters to the editor kind of articles where you can tell Victor Green's been trying to get North Dakota to participate. And they have all these, it's really great. They have these letters, you know, explaining why they can't or why the, you know, there's just not many Black people around here. And there's still, you know, kind of an oddity. And it's just, you know, it's horror, it's cringeworthy. But it was what he was up against. And yet, you know, when you look at it and it's so, it's just, you just see business after business and pages and hundreds, you know, like some editions are over 100 pages. It just, it's incredible what he did.
It is. And you've talked about a kind of, first an entrepreneurial template that you mentioned, Maggie, Madam C.J. Walker, I'm sorry, though Maggie Walker was a very renowned banker.
Mm-hmm.
Banker in Richmond, Virginia. Mm-hmm. But that community, and you've talked about ESSO a little bit. Let's talk a little bit more about that. I mean, there's something pretty extraordinary about a major corporation, Standard Oil, ESSO Standard Oil, mm-hmm. Feeling obliged to look at humans who are Black Americans as human and realize that there was potential there. Could you talk a little bit more about ESSO?
Absolutely.
And that relationship?
Yes. I'm happy to talk about ESSO. My gosh, ESSO was Standard Oil at the time, and they distributed the Green Book, but they were so far beyond and ahead, you know, in terms of race relations. They really were on the right side of history. And they hired Black people not to just work at their gas stations. They hired Black folks to franchise their own gas stations. They hired Black people at every level of their business. There were Black chemists at ESSO. They hired two Black marketing executives, James Jackson and Wendell P. Alston, who teamed up with Victor Green. And essentially that, I think, was between that and the Postal Service, that's why we are talking about the Green Book today. I really do believe that. And, you know, when I was looking at my research, when I was writing my book, I thought, well, why in the world was Esso so kind? I mean, they really went above and beyond to Black folks. And then I learned about Rockefeller. John D. Rockefeller ran Standard Oil. And I learned about his wife, Laura Spelman. And she was a white woman who grew up in a house that was on the Underground Railroad in Cleveland, Ohio. And she was very, her parents were fierce, fierce abolitionists. And I believe that she was the conscience of Rockefeller, just saying, do the right thing here. And he did. And of course, Spelman College was named after their family. And, you know, they did a lot of important work. So thankfully, and I think it's also inspiration. I mean, Esso is now ExxonMobil today, who's our sponsor for this exhibition, which is a perfect fit because they really did. They are deeply tied and committed to this history. So we were, you know, thrilled to have them actually support the exhibition. But I think it's also a great opportunity to show how corporations really can step in and become a real ally to the Black community. I mean, I think it's a really, because like I said, they didn't have to do this. And it's not like they were basically, they weren't giving handouts. They were just offering opportunities that were available to everybody else.
Yes, at this time, we are in a Jim Crow world. Segregation, colored and white, are real, separate interests. And in the North, if you were African-American wanting to buy an outfit, you couldn't try it on in the store. Mm-hmm. This is pretty unique as a corporation that has a sense of humanity and vision. It is a pretty unique reality. And still, in listening to you talk about Victor Green and the partnership with Esso via two Black marketing execs, Jackson being one of them, I keep thinking about the community. And you alluded to it a bit. And frankly, I think it's all part of the story. How would you describe how the Green Book fostered community and foster connections?
Well, I think the main issue with segregation, it was a double-edged sword, right? Because in so many ways, since Black folks couldn't actually go to other places, like say, take the Dewdrop, for instance, in New Orleans, the Dewdrop was so powerful and such an iconic place because Black folks couldn't go to the French Quarter. And it became so incredible to white folks because there was so much talent there. There were so many things happening at the Dewdrop. They wanted to be there too. And then it kept getting shut down because they kept getting, you know, you couldn't have integration. So the fact that Black people made something in these communities that was so popular with so much talent, that had so much reach, that everybody wanted to be a part of, even during segregation, it became this thing, this special thing that we had in our communities. So I think the Green Book fostering that kind of, if you could just get to the neighborhood, that's partially what the Green Book did. You didn't even have to really say, I'm going to this particular hotel. If you saw Auburn Street a bunch of times in the, you know, in the Atlanta section, you figured, I need to go to Auburn. You know, that's how a lot of Black folks traveled. Once you got to the Black neighborhood, then you could relax and you could have fun, then you knew you were okay. And so there were these safe zones in between these very scary moments and times, especially heading north, west, other parts of the country, where you had these sundown towns. They were more popular in the north and the west than they were in the south by far. So they're really a northern and western construct. So the Green Book didn't make it safe. It couldn't control what would happen to you while you were out there on the road. But once you got into the neighborhood that was the safe zone and that community that was looking out for each other, I think it fostered this real sense of we're in this together. You know, there is this them and us situation. And I think it really helped create a safe zones, just pockets all over the country.
How did the Green Book change over time, Candacy?
You know, it's interesting. And I really loved that, because I wrote my book and I put it chronologically, and I looked at editions over time, because I really wanted to see how the Green Book really changed. And it really did. It was very significant, because earlier editions, the late 30s into the early 40s, and even into the late 40s, it was all pretty much any kind of business you could imagine. Banks, liquor stores, drug stores, anything you could imagine. And then in this, right when integration appears to be on the horizon, right before Brown versus Board of Education, looks like, you know, a lot of people are in America are thinking, okay, even if we don't want to integrate, this is what's coming. And so you do see a shift in the Green Book in terms of the types of businesses. It becomes more of, it changes its layout entirely. There's not the two column format anymore. It's one column. There's about half the amount of businesses are listed in there in the later editions. There's a lot more white owned businesses that are a lot larger. The Waldorf Astoria, really fancy places come into play. I believe this was also a time when people like Sammy Davis Jr. were getting in the media where, oh, he can't stay here. Well, the Bel Air was in the Green Book in LA, so he knew he could stay there. I think it was fostering the celebrity culture, but also the tide was changing, and you saw a lot fewer of these. So all the kind of more obscure places, like, you know, a lot of the barbershops and the beauty shops and all that, they're gone by the later editions. It's just really more like a AAA guide. It's just food and lodging. Yeah.
Victor Green is quoted as saying, one day we won't need this. We won't need this guide. How does the Green Book stop publication? Why does it happen? And what's the outcome with the ceasing of the Green Book publication?
Don't know exactly why it stopped, but we know, I mean, based on what I know about the Green Book, really it's, you see that Victor Green dies in 1960, so that's pretty significant. And then Alma Duke Green basically gives or sells, we don't know if she actually got money for it, but she turns over the Green Book to Langley Waller and Melvin Tapley. And they were part of the New York Amsterdam News. They had been, you could see moments of them coming through. This is the last edition of the Green Book that's posted here. And it's crazy because it's the first, it's the only edition that doesn't have any green on the cover. It's got this woman, she's half in a, you know, ski suit and a snow suit. She's got this gidget energy. It's odd, right? But it's pretty spectacular.
Covering all bases for travel and enjoyment.
Right. I mean, it really does become, and interestingly enough, it does become more of a political guide. It never had that tone. I don't think Victor Green was really about that. So when Tapley and Waller take it over, it does have a slightly different, more, and but also the country was more political in the 60s too. That was the wave of what was happening. So you see these, you know, it ends in 1967. The last two editions are double year editions, meaning there was a 63-64 edition. We don't know, as far as we know, there's no 1965 edition. And then you get the 66-67 edition, and then it ends. So that's, couple of years after the Civil Rights Act, the passage of the Civil Rights Act. So I guess people figured it was time. There was this idea that we theoretically could legally go to most other places, although there were still shenanigans and covert operations trying to get in our way. But you know, I think that was, you know, that was when it was a lot of, most of the other major travel guide and other big Black traveler guides, one was called Travel Guide, also ceased. So, yeah.
I love you putting it in context. But if we were to look at the Green Book's end, because in desegregation has started to occur, Jim Crow is no longer the law of the land. Mm-hmm. What is the legacy of the Green Book? And then what is the impact of that time on original Green Book sites? What's happening? And we're looking at some of your images right now of Green Book sites, if you don't mind. Mm-hmm. Incorporating all of that.
Sure, sure. Yeah, the Green Book, you know, really, as I said, when the once segregation was really kind of on its last, when we really could integrate, a lot of times this was a dewdrop. We left and we went to the French Quarter because we could finally go to the French Quarter. And sadly, these places were abandoned and they fell into ruins. The Hampton House was another one. Just literally, there was a tree growing into the pool where Dr. King would swim with his family. So it was a real, it's a shame. I mean, we do have some of these left and some of them are, have been restored into their former glory. They're beautiful. But for the most part, it was a very urban renewal happened, wrecking ball. I mean, literally I would go and scout 30 Green Book sites that day and 20 of them were just replaced by a freeway. So that was real. We lost these places through government, you know, social forces, through abandonment. When Black folks who had means could leave these communities, they did. So that is our legacy in terms of, you know, really what I think where we were as a people really did shift, but the courage and brilliance to find solutions to very, just, I think that's the essence of what the Green Book did. And I think it also mirrors the essence of who we are as a race. You know, I think the fact that this monumental change can come from such a simple thing, it's almost like Steve Jobs putting a camera in a phone. Who knew that would become a revolutionary tool, right? And I think in the same way the Green Book was, I think it was just that brilliant.
Well, I want to thank you for your brilliance, because out of your brilliance, the Smithsonian is traveling an exhibition on the Green Book that profiles and highlights the brilliance, the elegance, the ingenuity, and the fact that these businesses were real. This exhibition travels around the nation, going to over 12 sites. We are now at our affiliate, National Civil Rights Museum in Memphis. We will be going to Atlanta, to Little Rock, Baton Rouge, Sacramento, Tacoma, Washington. I'm gonna go through the whole list very quickly. Jackson, Mississippi, Irvine, Texas, Skokie, Illinois, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, Houston, Texas, and Los Angeles. And thanks to you, Candacy, for bringing your vision for why this was an American story to the Smithsonian. It's been wonderful to talk to you tonight.
Thank you, Marquette. Thank you, everybody. This has been an honor to be a part of this and to share this history and to do this work. So I think we're all better for it.
Well, thank you, Candacy and Marquette. That was so wonderful. I'm going to quote Timothy in the chat, who said, "The chat is lit because the chat has been on fire." It has been so awesome. I mean, I have hardly been able to keep up with it, but there have been so many great comments and people sharing resources and stories and asking questions. And we do have some really fantastic questions as well. So we will not be able to answer them all, but we'll answer a few of them and hope that people will be intrigued enough to want to learn more on their own. So a question that's come up a couple of times is, can you talk about what sundown towns are? That's not a familiar term to everyone.
Yeah, I realize I didn't really explain that. Sundown towns were all white towns. They were all white on purpose. And they were really, like I said, a northern and kind of western construct. They were basically, some would have a sign saying inward, don't let the sun set on you here at the county line. Some would have a bell. They'd ring it at 6 p.m. That meant anybody Black better leave. Most of the laborers and people who worked in sundown towns knew the deal. But the danger of sundown towns was when you've got about 1.5 million Black folks fleeing racial terror that were migrating out of the South into the North. They didn't know. There was no sundown town map. There was no internet, you know, showing them where to go around. And like I said, half the counties on Route 66 were sundown towns. So it was a very, and places like LA, for instance, was ringed by sundown towns. Glendale, Burbank, Culver City were all sundown towns. So it wasn't that, you know, just the West was more liberal, because in a lot of ways it really wasn't. They just didn't have, I think in some ways the North and the West and other places just didn't have the courage to say what they really meant. You know, it's like, they seem to be celebrated for not having the colored and white signs, but really those were more useful when you were on the road and you didn't know the community. You needed a sign sometimes to say, okay, I get it. So they were very real. And I would definitely defer anyone to look at James Lowen's book, Sundown Towns. His research on that is really extensive and great.
Great, thank you. We have a question from Cynthia, who is curious about how Victor Green financed the Green Book. How did he do this work?
Well, you know, he definitely did make some money from the actual advertisements that were larger that he did charge for. He didn't die a rich man. I did find in the 40s some of his tax, he basically made about as much as a postman made and just a little more. I mean, it wasn't a money-making venture, but it was enough to keep it going. And I think that was a point. He had an office that was above Small's Paradise in Harlem, and he had a staff, and it was a viable business, and it was, you know, had editors, and it was an established thing, but it wasn't a big money maker.
Right. I'm scrolling through the questions here. There's so many great ones. As you've been doing your research, Candacy, and Marquette, as you've been working on the exhibition, have you talked with descendants of families who own Green Book sites, or how has that informed your research, you know, sort of oral histories, or, you know, talking to people who were there?
I'll say quickly, and then you can jump in, Marquette, but I did get a grant from the Library of Congress to interview Green Book business owners. And so I was able to thankfully get Leah Chase's story before she passed, who ran Dookie Chase's, and the man who was a barber for King at the Benmore Hotel, and then Sweats, who we have featured in the exhibition. And those interviews should be available in about 6 months on the Library of Congress website. So anybody's able to get to I believe we have the link to my website. If you sign the guest book, I can give you updates on when that's available. But Marquette, what was your experience in terms of like having access or learning these stories about these people?
Affirming, to tell you the truth. It really rather wonderful to talk to people who are usually relegated to the shadows of history, to meet people who are in the 80s or people who are in the 50s and 60s who were around when the elders owned these businesses, and have that pride of purpose and agency kind of wash over you. It's actually one of the reasons why, and it is worth noting that primarily the research is Candacy's. I just storytell with exhibitions. I take great content and try to make it visual. But because of the people, you'll see if you get an opportunity to see the exhibition, it's populated with humanity. Elegant, interesting, broadly diverse humanity, all Black Americans who were real.
It was
informing. It was rich to have that. That's my experience, just rich and affirming.
And I just want to say that as we were preparing the presentation for this evening, Marquette just kept saying over and over again, you know, we have to show people, you know, we have to show the vibrancy. And she was right. And I hope that the photos really communicated that to our audience, because I think you were right, Marquette, really showing the humanity and the vibrancy, and that this wasn't a story of victimization at all. And I think that your conversation tonight really brought that through. And I think the photos really accented that. So I think we've got time for a few more questions. Did listing in the Green Book have any negative consequences for business owners? Were there local reactions that put owners out of business or at risk in any way?
I mean, I think because of the times, right, that was, you didn't really need to be in the Green Book to have bad things, you know, or good things happen to you. I mean, I think it was depending on where you were. We definitely, Majeska Simpkins is a woman who I loved her her story, and she was a NAACP. She started so many different chapters in NAACP in South Carolina. She's from Columbia, and I interviewed her niece, Henri Treadwell, and her place was shot up by the Ku Klux Klan many, many times. But again, I don't think it had anything to do with her being in the Green Book. It was just that she was a Black business that was probably doing well, and they didn't like that. There were definitely plenty of white businesses who wanted to participate or make money or whatever from, take opportunities from the fact that there were so many Black people on the road. And it was a huge money market. I mean, most business people, it just made good common sense to, you know, get business wherever you could get it. So, but yeah, there were definitely repercussions. But again, I don't know if that's, I think it's tied to the just reality of that time. Not really just to the Green Book didn't become like a, oh, you better not advertise in there, you're going to have trouble. I just think.
I agree. It seems to me that overarchingly, that was the general feeling with people who advertise in Green Book. But we did come across an Esso station owner family, that Black owned, proud of that Black ownership, but refused to advertise in the Green Book because their primary clientele were chauffeurs of very rich white business people from Wall Street, etc. And they purposefully didn't advertise in Green Book for fear that their white clientele would not patronize their business.
Mm. Interesting. In addition to all the great questions that we've gotten, we've also had some really interesting comments and stories. Sabrina posted that she said, I work in education and I introduced my students to the Green Book this past February. They loved it. My principal allowed me to decorate my classroom door and the students would stop by and read my door daily. Students in grades 2nd through 8th, my door looked like a real replica of the Green Book. So thanks for sharing that, Sabrina. It's wonderful to know that you're bringing this history to even our youngest students. So let's see. I think we've got probably time for one or two more questions.
One thing really quickly. I'm sure. Sorry. I didn't mention that there will be a children's book based on my book coming out for ages 9 to 12. So that'll be out in fall of 2021 for educators who want to.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
That's great. That's a great resource to look out for.
Go ahead.
I'm glad you shared that. Let's see, I'm just scrolling through here. Candacy, how has your mapping project coming along? How many of the 10,000 Green Book listings have you mapped?
I've mapped all of them. I've visited over 5,000 of them.
Wow.
And I photographed about 170 of them. But I'm working on a digital interactive map that I got seed money from National Geographic. And that the base map of that will be done by the end of the year, but it's also tracing Black social mobility beyond through the lens of the Green Book. So it's looking at all these different layers of how mobility has been challenged or really inspired by Blackness, whether it's, you know, these real horrible things like lynching sites all the way up to mass incarceration, but also these other facilities and how people travel through the country using, whether it was the Underground Railroad or the Green Book or the migratory patterns that people traveled. So yes, if you wanna find out more about it, just email me and I'll put you on my updates list when that comes out.
Great.
Thanks for asking.
Well, thank you both so much. It's hard to believe that an hour has already gone by. This was just so fascinating. I felt like I thought I knew a lot about Green Book, and I certainly learned so much more tonight from both of you. So thank you, Marquette.
Thank you,
Candacy. And thank you to our affiliate partners for helping to share this with your communities. Thank you to the affiliation staff who you don't see because they're all behind the scenes making the Zoom look seamless and making it all work. Thank you all so much for joining us this evening. And we hope to you'll join us again soon for another program. So thanks everyone and have a good night.
Oh, thank you. Good night. Thank you for having us. Bye.